Colossians chapter 1, we're going to be looking at a lot of verses in chapter 1, but just to get our mind toward what we're going to be studying today, let's just do a scripture reading beginning at verse 20. Colossians chapter 1, verse 20. It says, "And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight, if ye continue in the faith grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which ye have heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister." Now you note that wasn't the end of a sentence, but we'll talk about that as we study the passage together in just a little bit. Let's ask the Lord's help in this study tonight, today. Our God and our Father, we do thank you for our gathering here, as we've already stated. And now, Father, we thank you for a passage of Scripture that demands our attention and our concentration. And we pray that we might get a blessing out of a difficult passage of Scripture to understand maybe some deeper truths about your grace. And so we pray your help, illumination. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. There's a warning there in verse 23. Sometimes in your Bible, when you study the word if, there's really three kinds of ifs. There is an if that's directly conditional, like when you talk about in the gospel account, where it talks about the if you forgive your brother his trespasses, then your heavenly Father will forgive you. That if is a condition. If you forgive, then you receive forgiveness. Now, that's not the message of grace today. Today, you're to forgive because you are forgiven, and that's because of the cross work of Christ and our faith in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. But I just bring that up to your attention, that is an if of condition. Then there's an if, like if you just flip over to Colossians chapter 3 and verse 1, it says, "If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above." And that if in that passage is if, and it is the case. It's not a conditional if. It's, you know, it's just a not a hypothetical. It's a statement of fact, actually. If, and this is the case, then this is what's true. But then there's another if in the Bible that is a conditional if, but it's not a condition of absolute. It's more of a if so be, if this is the situation. And it still is a condition, and that's that verse 20, chapter 1, verse 23, but it's describing a certain condition, a certain situation. Now, I just say that to you because we've been talking about the ABCs of salvation. You probably thought I was already done with that a long time ago. But we talked about, in talking about the ABCs of salvation, we talked about salvation from the penalty of sin. We talked about the security of our salvation in Christ. And then we talked about the assurance of our salvation in the gospel. And we called that the ABCs of salvation. But when we were teaching that, I told you, especially when it comes to security and assurance, that there are those who teach, not necessarily in grace, but there are those in Christendom that teach a person can lose salvation. And what we did in our study is, after we talked about our security and our assurance in the gospel, to know for sure that we're absolutely saved because we're eternally secure when we trust Jesus Christ as our Savior, when we taught that, we realized that the ones who are teaching that you can lose salvation are those who don't know the difference between the gospel of the kingdom and the gospel of the grace of God. They don't know the difference between God's program for the nation of Israel and God's program for the body of Christ. They don't know the difference between Israel's epistles, what God has said to them concerning their promises and their calling, and the epistles to the body of Christ, our epistles, that are found in Paul's epistles, Romans to Philemon. So, and because they don't know that, they end up mixing the gospel of the kingdom with the gospel of the grace of God. And even in Israel's salvation, once someone's saved, they're saved. But there was a time in which there was the promise of salvation until they were able to be born again. And there's still a warning to the Hebrew people in general about who's going to endure to the end. Those are the ones that are going to be saved. And only the believer will God empower to make it to the end, because his purpose in that tribulation is to weed out the wheat and the tares, as it says in the book of Matthew. But that's all Israel's program. When it comes to Paul's epistles, we said that those who think that you can lose salvation, there's only two verses that I know of that have any I mean, they use other verses totally out of context. It's so easy to see how incorrect they are. But those who teach you can lose salvation, there's two verses in Paul's epistles that have to be looked at a little closer. And one we've already studied, and that's Galatians chapter 5 and verse 4, where it says, "Ye are fallen from grace." But we studied that closer, we found out we're not talking about people losing salvation, we're talking about people who are saved, eternally secure, who are believers, they've actually trusted in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ for their sins, but they're trying now to serve the Lord and live for the Lord under the law, because they've been taught incorrectly. And as a result of that, they're not availing themselves to the Spirit of God that now works in the believer. They're not availing themselves to the grace of God that motivates the believer. They're not availing themselves to the life of Christ that's in them. They're doing it. And they're falling from grace in the sense that they're not availing themselves to the power of the Christian life. It doesn't mean they're losing salvation at all. They're just losing the means by which God has empowered their life to be approved unto Him. So we studied that. But the second passage of Scripture that they would go to in Paul's epistles is Colossians chapter 1 in verse 23. Again, I'll read verse 22 with it. It says, I have to read verse 21. "And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight, if ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister." And so that one here is going to take a little bit more study, a little bit more time to understand. I would say out of those two, this one probably is the most misunderstood, requires a little bit of biblical, not a little bit, it requires a mature understanding. And I would say this, notice in verse 23, already expressed in that verse, it says, "If you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel." Now notice the last part of that sentence, that verse, "which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister." And especially as you reach down, he's going to talk about, like in verse 25, "whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given me to you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and generations, but now is made manifest to the saints." That in the context of what Paul's talking about, you can see clearly there needs to be a mature dispensational understanding of Paul's ministry to us Gentiles, which people who don't understand this passage and try to use it to teach you can lose salvation, they have no concept of that at all. But to understand that verse 23 is going to require a mature dispensational understanding. When I say mature, I have verse 1 of Colossians 1 in mind. It says, "Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus our brother, to the saints and faithful in Christ Jesus, which are at Colossae, grace to you and peace from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ." Paul, when he writes to the Colossians, he's not just writing to believers, the saints. He's writing to the saints and the faithful. Faithful means full of faith. The Colossians are like the Ephesian saints. They know, they're not only saved, they're mature, they've understood some things, they're full of faith. And Paul can tell them some things because of their maturity that he couldn't say to like the Corinthians and certainly to the Galatians. And so just knowing that wherever you are in your study, you're going to get matured in grace if you aren't there already. But it's going to take that maturity to understand verse 23. Now, there's generally said that there's two camps out there. And by the way, don't let people throw you in one of those camps. They said there's the Arminian camp and there's the Reformed Calvinist camp, and you got to be one of those two. Either you're Arminian or you're Calvinist. And hopefully you need to say, "No, I'm a dispensationalist." There's another camp they're not even considering, which is neither Arminian nor Calvinistic. But just take those two, for instance, the two camps, the Arminian and the Calvinist, both of them go to this passage to prove their point. Trouble is, there's two different points. They don't agree among themselves. But they both go to this passage to prove their point, and the warning that I want you to get from this is that both of them, in going to prove their point from this passage, pervert the gospel of the grace of God. And what I mean by that is the Arminian, that's the group of in Protestant theology that believe in, they stress free will. But in the stressing of free will, they teach that a person can lose their salvation. And they go to this verse and say, see, you're saved if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, be not moved away from the hope of the calling. And if you get moved away, you lose your salvation. And they go to this passage to teach that. But then there's the other side, or the other group, called the Calvinist. And they don't believe in free will. But they also don't believe you can lose your salvation. What's strange is, we believe in free will, and we don't believe you can lose salvation, so we're neither one of those two, but each one of them had a point there. But they don't believe you can lose salvation, but what they teach is, they say, now see, here's proof text that if someone has genuine faith, God-given faith, not your faith, but God-given faith, that you will continue in the faith grounded and settled. And they would look at that word if there, saying it's like, in a sense, hypothetical, but the true believer will continue, and if you were only you invented your own faith, you just believed because you said you believed, and it wasn't God giving you faith inside of you. That's how they don't quite say it that way, but that's what they mean. That anyhow, this proves that a true believer will continue in the faith. Now, if you think about either one of those, what both of those two groups are saying is that the assurance of your salvation is in your performance. You're saved, and you know you're going to be saved because you're going to continue in the faith, and you're going to do that, and therefore you're not going to lose your salvation by your performance of continuing in the faith. The Calvinist says, no, you're saved, you'll continue in the faith because God gave you the faith, but how do you know that you have the true faith of God? Is because you're going to continue in the faith, your performance. Neither one puts the assurance of their salvation in the grace of God, undeserved, unmerited favor, based on the cross of Christ at Calvary. Now, they don't say it that way because they try to attribute all that to the cross, but when they're actually saying that is, you know you're saved because of what you do. And they pervert the gospel of the grace of God in the process. So both of those ideas are dangerous. Now, there's a lesson I want you to teach you even before I teach you the passage. And that is, even if you come to Colossians chapter 1, verse 23, and you go, what is that verse saying? And you don't have an understanding of what that verse means, don't throw away what's clearly taught in Scripture from a passage that you don't understand. What I mean by that is, Romans 5, 1 says, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God. There's a verse that really clear, after you get to Romans 3, 4, and 5, makes it really clear that when you trust the death, burial, and resurrection, and it's not continuing to trust until you die, it's the moment you trusted the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ as the payment of your sin, God has declared you righteous, and you have peace with God. Now, that's not just for now, that's forever. And so you don't throw a verse like that away because, oh, I don't understand this verse, so I must not really have continuous peace with God. So you don't throw verses like that away. By the way, you don't throw away Romans 8, and you go all the way from 31 to 39, the end of that chapter, where it starts out, if God be for us, who can be against us? And it goes on to talk about nothing can separate you from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus the Lord. And throw that wonderful passage out because you come here and say, I don't understand what this means. That passage is really clear that when you trust Christ, you have God the Father who declared you righteous, no one can say anything else, and Jesus Christ who makes intercession for you, and no one's going to outdo him in court before God the Father, and then the Spirit just saying, nothing shall separate you from the love of God. And so you don't have to worry about a verse like this in light of those other passages. 2 Corinthians 6:11 that says, ye are washed, ye are sanctified, ye are justified in the name of the Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. That's, you're washed, you're sanctified, set apart unto God as holy and declared righteous by God. You don't throw a verse like that away when you come to a passage like this. You don't throw away 1 Corinthians 15 verses 1 through 4. where verse 2 says you're saved, if you remember what Paul preached, and then what he preached is how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Verse 2 says you're saved if you believe that. Not probation, salvation. So you don't throw it out, you don't throw that verse away because you don't understand this. You don't throw away Ephesians 1, 12 through 14 that says, after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. After that you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit unto the day of redemption, unto the purchased possession, unto the praise of God's glory. You don't throw a verse that says, soon as you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit unto the rapture is what it's talking about, the day of redemption, the redemption of our bodies. So you don't throw a verse like that away, and certainly you're not going to throw Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 away. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So, you know, we go on and on. There's the point is you don't throw away clear verses from a passage that you don't understand. And then whatever you do or you don't understand from Colossians chapter 1, verse 23, you know that that verse is not teaching a person can lose salvation because of the context of Colossians. For instance, Colossians, we already talked about verse 2 there, to the saints and faithful in Christ Jesus. Paul calls them saints. Think any saints are going to end up in hell? Saints set apart as holy unto God. And faithful, these people are faithful. If you look down in verse 4, Paul says, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. Now, that is a real important part to that. Understand, it's not continued faith in Christ Jesus. That's what a lot of people try to do. That your salvation takes place the moment you come to a decision, you realize that you're a lost sinner and there's nothing you can do to save yourself. There's nothing you can do to erase those sins and make God accept you. Except you can understand what Christ did for you. And that He is the propitiation for sin. He's the one who died for your sins. He's the payment that's been made in your behalf. And when you, by faith, trust that, God saves you. So when Paul says, since we heard of your faith, you enter into faith the moment you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you're saved at that moment, not saved later. So when Paul says, since the day we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have toward all the saints, and notice this, the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. And I don't want to go into it, but you need to have a biblical understanding of the word hope. The biblical understanding of the word hope is a sure expectation of a future glory. It's not, I hope I make it. The hope that we have is God assuring us that our future is going to take place. And you live in that expectation of the assured hope that you have in Christ. And I say that to you because this hope that's laid up for them in heaven, it's not if you continue in the faith, they have it. In fact, if you consider what's said in verses 4 and 5, then you realize that the if over in verse 23 has to be a future if, something about the future. And not something about the future of the Colossians that were living when Paul wrote to them. Everything's secure, and they're not moved away from the hope of the gospel. So that whatever verse 3 is about, it has a future tone to it that is beyond the Colossians themselves. And that's important to grasp right now, as you'll see later. But Paul writing to them is not all of a sudden in verse 22 saying, well, I'm not sure you're going to make it. And you got to endure to the end or continue to make it, that verse means something else. And you know that by these verses that he's talking to them about. Even in verse 6, which is come unto you, that is this gospel message, the hope of the gospel, the truth of the gospel, which is come unto you as it is in all the world and bringeth forth fruit as it doth in you also, does also in you, since the day ye heard it and knew the grace of God in truth. So, these people have fruit in their life because of understanding that message. And as such, they're called saints and faithful and so forth. Colossians 1 and verse 13, I'll read verse 12 with it. It says, 12 says, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. They're already a partaker of the future inheritance. Verse 13, who hath delivered us, that's past tense, from the power of darkness and hath translated past tense, us into the kingdom of God's dear Son. They're in. Amen. They're not waiting to get in, they're in. So that whatever verse 13 is talking about, these people can't lose what they got. And you know that from the context of Colossians here. In verse 14, look what else they have. In whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sins. They're pretty well set, aren't they? Verse 21, now this one we'll look at a little closer, but it says, and you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your minds by wicked works, yet now hath He reconciled. These people are reconciled unto God, redeemed, forgiven. But also, if you look at verse 6 of chapter 2, it says, as ye therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in Him. These people have already received Christ Jesus the Lord. Paul said, if you receive the message I preach to you, you're saved. So these people are saved and secure in the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no question about that in these believers. And then, boy, we can just keep going on these. Well, verse 10, ye are complete in Him, which is the head of all principalities and powers. And then maybe you need to just look a little closer. In verses 11 through 13 here, where it talks about in Christ, and that's where we are as believers, we're already circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. That is, God has put away the body of sin. And we're baptized, it says verse 12, buried with Him in baptism. That is, we've been placed into the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ by the operation of God. So that verse 13, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh hath He quickened together with Him. We're made alive together with Christ, having forgiven you all trespasses. But that idea of us being dead, sin is done away with, cut away, removed from us, because we've died with Christ. And we've been risen with Christ, and God has circumcised us and baptized us into the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ and forgiven us all trespasses. So anyhow, in light of verses like that, you realize verse 23 must not mean you can lose your salvation. It must mean something else. And it's going to take a deeper understanding in the sense that I told you that these Colossian saints are mature believers. Look at chapter 2 again. And verse 1 indicates that they've never met Paul, but they got grounded in Paul's message. And he prays, his thoughts for them, or his prayer for them in chapter 2, verse 2, it says, that your hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of the Son, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Paul's talking about them being able to have full assurance of understanding. See, Paul's dealing with, he's not dealing with carnal saints or the Galatian saints that are getting away, perverting the gospel of grace. These saints are mature, and Paul talking about them having full assurance of understanding. That's why in verse 25 he talks about the revelation of the mystery was given to him to fulfill the word of God. He's able to bring them, Colossians 1 and verse 9, it says, for this cause we also, since the day we heard of it, cease not to pray for you and desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of His will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. It's like these saints who are faithful, Paul's writing to them to give them the whole package, the whole benefit, the capstone of truth. I keep saying that about Ephesians, because Ephesians and Colossians, that's the purpose of it, is for them to get the full revelation of what God's purpose and grace is all about. So he's not going back to salvation things and continuing the gospel here. He's making sure they get all of it. And so he's going to deal with them as mature saints. All that being said, okay, you realize then if this takes some degree of understanding and spiritual discernment, then we're going to have to do some Bible study. What we said in Sunday school, we studied the passage, study to show yourself approved unto God, thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. That the warning of that passage is there are some people that are teaching falsely, not rightly dividing the word of truth, and subverting the faith of some. Now what you need to do is you need to study to make sure someone doesn't do that. And you need to study rightly dividing the word of truth that you might not be deceived by someone who would pervert or subvert the gospel. So, but anyhow, the point of study there is we're going to now study. This is not a flowery study. We're going to have to look close and understand what this is. And to do that, You see, the context here is, if you back up in verse 1, 21, it says, chapter 1, verse 21, "And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled." Hopefully you were here last week, because I thought to myself, you know, I can't go to this passage of Scripture and talk about the depths of the reconciliation that God has provided in the age of grace. Last week I went all the way back to the beginning and reminded you what reconciliation is all about. That is a word that Paul says that his ministry and his message all centers around. We always use the word salvation. Paul said if you want one word to explain what God's doing today, it's reconciliation. And reconciliation means to restore to friendship and fellowship. And there's a sense in which when Paul brings that about, he reminds us that we were Gentiles, and as Gentiles, we were cut off from God. We're enemies of God by in our own minds and by our decision to turn away from God to idolatry. And God was only dealing with the nation of Israel until he raised up the Apostle Paul. And then there's a message that through the cross, God has reconciled those Gentiles back to himself and made us Gentiles savable. But he also says, be reconciled. That is, God's now offering us salvation because Jesus Christ, through what was preached by Paul, it's not that he just died for Israel as her Messiah to set up her kingdom. He died for all mankind to be testified in due time where Paul was made a minister. So that this message of reconciliation. Now, here's the point. In verse 23, when he says, if ye continue in the faith, there is two answers that people give of what that condition is in verse 23. And I think both thoughts are worth considering. I believe only one of them are true, but both of them are, I've thrown away all the false teaching. There's two of them that have biblical dispensational support by the grace of God or in the doctrines of grace that if could be referring to. Now today I'm going to teach you the one I think it is referring to. Next week, even though I don't believe it's what it is, there's many people who teach it, and it teaches a doctrine of grace that I don't think this passage is teaching, but is worth teaching. And therefore I can show you that they use this passage, it's taught in other places. So it'll be a positive lesson. And you might look at that and say, nah, Tom, you know, you think it means this, but I think it means that. The difference is this. The if in verse 23, does it go back to the word reconciliation in verse 21? We started there. It says, again in verse 21, "And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled," and it tells you how he did it. Then verse 23 says, "if ye continue." So is that a statement that goes back to the word reconciled? Or the other view is that if you continue, that condition goes back to the word present in verse 22. Verse 22 says, "in the body of his flesh through death, to present you a certain way, if ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled." Now, so anyhow, next week I'll show you how you can use that if to talk about how you're going to be presented. Because you are going to be presented before God the Father someday, or before the Lord Jesus Christ. But I actually look at that verse, and I understand in verse 21, in fact, I'm going to show you the context here, that I think the if goes back to the reconciliation, and the if in verse 23, I already pointed out to you that I believe it's a future reference, that it's a condition of how long the age and the ministry of reconciliation is going to go on, and what's going to bring it to an end. And there's another verse that will support it. So anyhow, there's two thoughts there. So let's get down to business now. What I want you to see is, if you go right to the beginning of this, you know, we've already pointed out they're the faithful, so they're strong in their faith. Notice verse 4 and 5, how closely that relates to verse 23. It says, since we heard of your faith in the Christ Jesus and your love toward which ye have to all saints, and the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the truth of the gospel, in the word of the truth of the gospel. So he's bragging about their faith, and by the way, you see the past tense, that's when they believed, that's past, and their love, that's what's continuing to operate right now in the age of grace, and the hope, that's reporting to the future. the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel. Now notice verse 23 again. If ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which ye have heard, and not only did they hear, which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I am Paul, and made a minister. So that's why I said, you know, they got, verse 23 is not operating in the Colossian church. So it's something that could happen in the future, and I believe if it's related to reconciliation, it's yet in our future as well. So that, anyhow, you see that relationship. Now, the other that I want you to see is, if you look at verse 9, and just kind of keep glancing at each verse all the way down to verse 17. Because I want you to see that's all one sentence. Paul's epistle sometimes, you know, he just starts going and he starts throwing spiritual truth at you like a machine gun. And when you look at that, you go, whoa, look at the length of that sentence. And the sentence, the way it's broken up is there's these semicolons along the way. Now, a semicolon can act as a period, but the King James translators didn't make these periods. They made them semicolons. It's colon. That's what I'm talking about here. That the colon is used sometimes like a semicolon. A semicolon is like a statement is made, and there's some added information, so they put a semicolon, add a little bit more information. But a colon itself can actually be a period with another thought. But it's the reason that you would use a colon instead of a semicolon is this is additional thought, but it's an emphasized additional thought. And I understand now why the colons are there. It's Paul makes a statement, he builds and builds and builds and gets so excited. It's connected to the previous thought, but it's an emphasis that's just adding more glory every time you move along in that. So when you look at that big long sentence, verses 9 through 17 there, verses 9 through 12 is Paul's prayer for us. And you can break up his prayer as he's praying by the colons or semicolons in that section. Then you begin in verse 13, where he goes from his prayer for us. In fact, you can see the twist, the turning in verse 12, where it says, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. And now he's going to start going from a prayer to what our part is in God's program, what God is accomplishing, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and translated us in the kingdom of his dear Son. Why did God do that? Keep those thoughts of why in mind. In whom we have redemption. In Christ we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Who, now he's going to add, not only are we translated into the kingdom and we're forgiven, but we're forgiven, all this is in Christ, and so he picks up in verse 15 about what Christ has accomplished. Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, powers, all things were created by him and for him. Now, even though I'm going to say this kind of fast, what there is in verses 13 through 17 is like six things that he's pointing out of what God's accomplishing in grace with us. One of the things, it's all centers in Christ, that's why verse 15 talks about Christ, and the all things that are in verse 16, notice they're not all beings, they're all things. They're governments. There is governments in the heaven, you know. Maybe you don't know. But there's governments on the earth, they're visible. But the governments in the heavens, they're invisible, but they're there. And there are some called principalities, power, dominion, and might. But there's not only of God's angels, but that's what Satan and his angels are sometimes called. So there is a rebellion of the heavenly government. That's where Satan is right now, rebelling against God's authority in the heavens. And God got a plan for both heaven and earth. So in verse 17 it says, and he is, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, is before all things, and by him all things consist. So that we've been now talking about God taking us and saving us and putting us in the kingdom of God's dear Son, because God's point is in verse 17, and he is before all things, Jesus Christ comes first, and by him all things consist. So they're all centered around Jesus Christ, and now you end up in verse 18 with a sentence of conclusion of why Paul said all this. And what's really amazing is, what is God's purpose for the body of Christ? Remember when we talk about right division? God has a purpose for Israel, and it's to set up a kingdom here on this earth through the nation of Israel. Where does Paul just come straight out and tell us what is the purpose for this mystery of the body of Christ, of forming the body of Christ? Well, he told us about those governments in heaven and earth, and says in verse 18, and he, the Lord Jesus Christ, is the head of the body, the church. Now, that's us. We are the church, the body of Christ, the believers today. Who is the beginning? Jesus Christ is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. He was the first to rise from the dead in a glorious body. For what reason? That in all things he might have preeminence. All the things in heaven and all the things in earth. All the government of heaven, all the government in earth. Well, we know how he's going to be the head of the government on earth. He's using Israel to set up a kingdom here on earth. So in verse 18, before I pass that up, he is the head of the body, who is the beginning and the firstborn from the dead. Why did he become the head of the body of Christ? Well, the point, that in all things he might have preeminence. He was going to have preeminence on the earth through the nation of Israel, and he will. It just hasn't happened yet. God has a program to be that Jesus Christ will be preeminent on the earth. But why did he form the body of Christ? Why are we going to be raptured, our hope of the gospel, raptured up into heaven? What is God's purpose for us? It's making Jesus Christ preeminent in the heavens. All things, heaven and earth, Jesus Christ will be preeminent. So that tells you the purpose for the body of Christ. Then verse 19, it tells you why this is God's purpose. For it pleased the Father that in him, in Jesus Christ, should all fullness dwell. So you realize what Jesus Christ is accomplishing and why it's being accomplished. It pleases God the Father that all the fullness will dwell in Jesus Christ. Then, beginning in verse 20, 19 and 20 is a sentence itself. It says, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him I say, whether they think be things in earth or things in heaven. So, to accomplish verse 19, we have been reconciled unto Jesus Christ. Now notice verse 21 is going to start another sentence. And you start looking down, where does that sentence end? It ends at verse 29, the rest of the chapter. So he's gone about what God's purpose in Christ is all about. And then when you get to verse 21, notice the switch. And you, that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your minds by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. So up to this time, it's been talking about God's purpose for the body of Christ, everything centered in Jesus Christ and his preeminence in all things. Now, beginning in verse 21, it's going to shift toward you and God's purpose for you, or us Gentiles in the age of grace, and that he has reconciled us. And in verse 22 says, in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. It says, if ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Now, it's important for you to understand, and I'm going to stop there, but what Paul does from that point, he talks about, which was preached to every creature under heaven. Paul, when he's in this passage, he's not just talking about what's preached to you as believers and what you believers received. He's talking about God and his purpose in turning to us Gentiles. And he sent Paul out to preach to every creature and extend to them the hope and the possibility of being part of God's purpose for the body of Christ, to become into the body of Christ and be part of God's purpose. I say that to you because, you know, then he's going to talk about the mystery revealed to him and so forth. Even look at verse 28. Well, let me read verse 27 and 28. I think you'll see this. In verse 27 it says, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. See that word Gentiles there? Paul's ministry is to every creature. Saved, and then hopefully get them lost, and then hopefully get them saved. But we're not just talking about Paul's message to the saved. We're talking that Paul, this glory, this mystery is being preached among the Gentiles. That's all beings, all creatures under heaven, which is in Christ, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's the message. So these Gentiles need Christ in them, and when they get saved, they get that. But verse 28 says, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. You see, the context of Colossians 1 is not just something to the believer. The context of Colossians 1 is God's ministry in this day of reconciliation to all mankind. That's why last week we studied about reconciliation, is God has reconciled the world unto himself today. And there's this message of reconciliation to be reconciled, but this message is going out for everybody because God has a purpose that he's going to conclude. The believer is going to be a part of this hope of glory. But the message goes out for everybody. So there's a sense, now you have to think about this, in verse 21, when it says, and you, is he talking about the believer? Or is he talking about, you can read it this way, and you Gentiles that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. See, that we taught that last week. We know that's true. Whether the context is here is general, your Gentiles are reconciled, and you're reconciled for a purpose. You're reconciled in the body of his flesh through death for a purpose, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. So God has reconciled all Gentiles so that of those Gentiles, some are going to be presented this way, and God's going to continue to do that if ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away. That's what God's doing presently right now, but there might come a time where God's not going to do that. Boy, time flies, does not? Come back to Romans. We'll see what we get out, and then wherever we have to pick up next week, we will. Romans chapter 11. I want to point something out to you. In Romans 11, we came to this passage to show how even the Jews who were once nigh to God have been cut off and become enemies, and they too, Jew and Gentile, Paul's message is to both of them, how they can be reconciled today because God has reconciled both through the cross to himself. So in verse 15 it says of Romans 11, for if the casting away of them, that's the Jews, be the reconciling of the world, well, lost Jews can be reconciled, they're part of the world. What shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead? So God in the future will receive Israel. I want you to see that they're cast away, but they're cast away so that now God is dealing with the whole world. And he's dealing with the whole world, not in judgment, but with reconciliation. So, as Paul explains this, he uses a term, let me just read the illustration, and we don't have time to go through every detail, but I'll make my point from it. Verse 16 says, for if the first fruits be holy, the lump is holy, and if the root be holy, so are the branches. So they're talking about when God was dealing with Israel, and they were the branches, and they were holy. But it goes on and says, and if some of the branches be broken off, and thou being a wild olive tree, the Gentiles, were grafted in among them, and with them partaker of the root and fatness of the olive tree, boast not against the branches. But if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. Thou wilt say, they were broken off. But thou wilt say, the branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. Now Paul's dealing with the fact that Israel, God broke off branches of the nation of Israel out of a olive tree, would be the place of life would flow from. They were broken off, but they can be grafted back in. And they're grafted in with us Gentiles. And we would say, well, they were broken off so that we could be grafted in. Well, Paul says, well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. Now, what I want you to understand, a couple things here. When Paul is talking about ye being grafted in, he's not talking about believers. Verse 13 says, for I speak unto you Gentiles. So, Paul's just talking about the Gentiles have been grafted. Israel had a place, but not all Israel was saved, right? The ones that were broken off were unbelieving Jews. God cut them off. But in being cut off, there's a message of reconciliation. They can be grafted in with the Gentiles. And now with the Gentiles, they have another opportunity to be blessed of God. So the Gentiles shouldn't brag. He says in verse 21, for if God spared not the natural branches, take heed lest he also spare not thee. Behold therefore the goodness and severity of God. On them which fell, severity, but toward thee, goodness, if thou continue in his goodness. Otherwise, thou also shall be cut off. Now, this is not believers being cut off. This is Gentiles who have been brought into a place of blessing where we can be received of God and receive life. The ones who in Israel didn't get saved were cut off in what? Unbelief. And he's now warning the Gentiles, you're in a place of blessing, you're in a place where you can be saved, you're reconciled unto me by the death of my son, but if you don't believe the gospel, you're going to get cut off. And we're not talking about believers being cut off, we're talking about dispensationally, God's going to cut off the age of grace and go back to dealing with the nation of Israel. That's what he says. Watch what he says. He says, and if they not abide still in unbelief, thou shalt be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. For if thou were cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted in contrary to nature into the good olive tree, how much more shall these, which be the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? For I would, brethren, that you should not be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceit, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in, and so all Israel shall be saved. Now my point to you is Paul's warning the Gentiles that you have this incredible opportunity in the age of grace to have Christ in you, the hope of glory. And that's being extended to you as long as you continue in God's goodness. And what that means is, if you follow Paul's ministry in the book of Acts, he would go to the Gentiles, and it's the Jews that would persecute him for preaching to the Gentiles, but the Gentiles were gladly receiving this truth. But you know, Israel had truth given to them for 2,000 years, and they quit listening to it, and God cut them off. Now, rather than judgment, in grace, everybody's had 2,000 years to enjoy this goodness of God's grace, to come to understand what Jesus Christ has done and be reconciled to God through the death of Jesus Christ. But if the Gentiles get to a point where they don't want to hear it anymore, I'm tired of hearing this Jesus saved stuff, that God is going to take and cut off the unbelievers, just like he did with Israel. He didn't cut off the believing Israel. He cut off the unbelievers, then change the dispensation. He's going to go back and deal with the nation of Israel again and bring in the final end days. The wrath is going to come. Now, I don't have time to conclude it any more than that right now. We'll start again there in Colossians. But I believe that the Colossians verse is not talking about the Colossians or you, once you get saved, continuing in the faith, and you'll be reconciled to God if you continue in the faith. I take that passage to be talking about generally us Gentiles who have been brought into this place of blessing so that we can be presented this way, and God will continue to take Gentiles and save them and present them this way if the Gentiles continue in the faith. Continue to receive and put their faith in Jesus Christ. And if he doesn't, and I'll add something to that next week, I'm not going to do it right now, but if the Gentiles decide they don't want to continue in God's goodness, God's going to end the age of grace, and you're going to go into the wrath of God and the end days. Now, I'll support that with another idea next week, but got you thinking about the ministry of reconciliation that's unique to the age of grace, and the warning, at least from Romans 11, it's not going to go on forever. I say that, you know, most people mock being saved and trusting Jesus Christ as their Savior. The world, for the most part, is tired of hearing it. And I think we're growing closer and closer to that time where the God says, okay, you don't want my grace, and he draws it away. If you're here today and you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, don't be mocking. There's coming a time where judgment's going to fall. You're only going to be presented holy and without blame if you're in Christ. And if you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, even though you're savable right now and God's offering you salvation, you're not saved till you put your faith in Jesus Christ, and then you are reconciled to God. You need to make that decision to trust Jesus Christ as your Savior. And it's important business, because when you read when this age of grace, the judgment and the wrath of God that's coming in the future, if you'd heed the warning of Scripture, you'd know you don't want to be a part of any of that wrath. You want to receive the reconciliation that's in Jesus Christ by trusting Christ today. Our God and our Father, I do thank you for a group of saints who like to study their Bible. And there's times there's easy verses to understand, and there's times that we need to have a depth of understanding. a spiritual discernment, dispensational discernment, to understand some of the things that were given to Paul to write and extend to us Gentiles, sometimes speaking to us as a whole, and another time speaking to us specifically as believers. Help us to think about these things and prepare to study it even further next week. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand and sing a little chorus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Dismissed.